Hello there, this is Explain to Myself, and welcome back to episode 2 of Information Theory, Explained to Myself. Last time, we learned how to measure information. The amount of information in something is the number of questions you would need to ask to figure that thing out. So if it's hard to understand that you need so many questions to get it, then it means it has a lot of information into it. But if you only need a few questions to figure it out, well, that means there isn't much information baked into it. And we ended with a scary looking formula that tells us exactly that. Shannon's entropy tells us the minimum number of questions we would need to ask on average. Minimum, because asking too many unnecessary questions is annoying, and on average, because things change and we don't always have the same thing. In the first video, I give you the intuition behind this formula and slowly build up into coming up with it on our own. It's worth a watch, totally unbiased. Now, we unlocked the ability to measure how much information is in things. Whoa. What do we do with it? Well, with this, we can literally know the theoretical best possible way to store some information without losing any. It tells you the absolute theoretical minimum storage needed for some information. I said theoretical twice. That's because if you do an oopsie and store the information in a sus questionable way, well, you know what, let me revive some anxiety for you. Imagine you're packing for a trip. Let's say that the stuff you need to bring with you occupies 40 liters of volume. So you would need at least a 40 liter suitcase. And this is where your Tetris skills come in. We all know that the way you pack affects how much you can fit, right? If you're not smart about it, you might waste some space and not be able to fit everything, even though the suitcase theoretically has enough space. If you're smart about it and lucky, you might be able to fit all the items, and you obviously won't fit more than 40 liters in the suitcase. That's the hard limit. I said lucky because if you're trying to pack circles in a rectangle, you're just cooked. You're bound to waste some space. Entropy tells you the tightest way you could ever pack some data or information, or how much you could compress it. Again, entropy tells you the minimum amount of storage you would need for some information. Anything less and some data is being left out. Say you have an image that's 1280 pixels by 720, in total 921,600 pixels. Each pixel stores three numbers, red, green, and blue, and each number takes 8 bits. So 24 bits per pixel times 921,600 pixels equals to 22,118,400 bits, or about 2.7 megabytes. So in theory, every image of that size should be 2.7 megabytes, right? And yet, that's not what we see. Some images are way smaller and they differ. Like this one, it's 1280 by 720, but only 983 kilobytes. So how did we make our images smaller than that 2.7 megabyte we calculated earlier? That's where compression comes in. Compression is all about removing unnecessary data. For example, in an image, you might see a zone where all the pixels are the same color. Instead of storing the exact color for every single pixel in that area, you could just say that all of them have the same color. This way, you don't need to repeat that information over and over again. You want to make sure that after you compress whatever it is you're compressing, you can still get back exactly what you started with when you need it. That's what we call lossless compression. No data is lost, it's just packed tighter. Now, compression can be very efficient, but there's a limit. There's always a limit. there's a limit to how much you can shrink data without losing any of it. Okay, let's get formal. Shannon's entropy tells us the theoretical minimum number of bits we'd need to represent something or some form of information. But sometimes, that number is not whole. Like, maybe the entropy of your data is 3.5. Problem is, and you probably guessed this, you can't store half a bit. Bits are indivisible. They're either 0 or 1. And since you can't go below 3.5 because that's the minimum, you'd need to round up. So you'll end up using 4 bits instead of 3.5. So you end up using 4 bits just to be safe. So in practice, to express some data, let's call it x, the number of bits you actually use, call it L of x, length, follows this rule. The entropy of x is smaller or equals to the number of bits you need to use to represent x, which is strictly smaller than the entropy of x plus 1. It means that we might sometimes be a little above the ideal, but never below it, and even when we go above the ideal, we don't go too far. Oh, by the way, there's a hidden dinosaur in the frame. I don't know if you spotted him, but hey, look for it. All right, so we've been talking about entropy, how much information is in things, or how many bits it takes to represent something. But let me ask you this. Does every message come out of nowhere? Sometimes you already know something that is linked to what's coming. And that changes how much information is left to figure out. Let's take an example. Suppose you get a text that says the capital of France is, let's call the beginning of the sentence Y, the context. You can probably already guess the missing information given the context. We call that missing information X. So knowing Y, you don't need to ask any more questions to know X. So the entropy of X knowing Y is 0. Now, you might be saying that the word Paris contains information. How come its entropy is 0? On its own, yes, X has entropy. But knowing the context Y, X doesn't tell you anything new because the context did most of the work. This is called conditional entropy. Regular entropy tells us how uncertain we are about X in general. But conditional entropy, written H of X bar Y, tells us how much uncertainty is left about X once you already know Y. In other words, how many bits do I still need to figure out X if I already know Y? A quick example. Let's say I'm thinking of a letter completely at random from the English alphabet. There are 26 letters and each one is equally likely. So the probability of any one letter is equals to 1 over 26. Now, we compute the entropy using Shannon's formula. Go back to the first video to know the inner workings of this formula and how to use it. Since every letter has the same probability, this simplifies to this, which gives us around 4.7 bits. And as we've said earlier, since there's no such thing as a fraction of a bit, we round up to 5. So, it takes about 5 bits to identify a completely random letter in the English alphabet. Now let's try that again, but this time I tell you, it's a vowel. Now your possibilities are down to A, E, I, O, U. Just 5 letters. Already, this piece of knowledge feels very helpful. So now you're picking randomly from 5 options. Each vowel has probability P of X, knowing that the letter is a vowel, equals to 1 over 5. So the conditional entropy, given that we know it's a vowel, is around 2.32 bits. Round that up and it's 3 bits. So just by knowing it's a vowel, we dropped from 5 bits to 3 bits. That's the magic of conditional entropy. entropy tells you how much information you would need or how many questions you would need if you know nothing. Conditional entropy tells you how much is left to learn once you already know something.
Quick question.
Say X is the thing you want to know, and Y is some knowledge or context you already have. Is this always true? H of X knowing Y is smaller or equals to H of X? Pause the video to think it through. Yes, of course it is. Knowing more stuff cannot make it harder for you to figure something out. You can't have more left to learn once you already know something. That makes no sense. Worst case scenario, the knowledge you have is irrelevant. No harm done. It doesn't help, but it doesn't hurt either. Take the example of trying to figure out a letter in the English alphabet. We already know that it would take around 4.7 bits, round up, that's 5 bits. Now, if I told you that I like Dark Souls, does that help you figure out which letter it is? It doesn't. But is it harmful? No. It's simply irrelevant. It doesn't help. It doesn't hurt either. The clue might be useless, but it does not add uncertainty. That's why this inequality is always correct. Now, so far, we've been talking about how much uncertainty there is in one variable. But what if you're trying to guess two things at once? That is where joint entropy comes in. Let's say you're trying to figure out both a fruit and its color. You've got these possibilities. The fruit could be either apple, banana, grape, or lemon. The colors are red, yellow, green, and purple. Let's say X is the fruit and Y is the color. To find out the entropy of both X and Y, for fruits, H of X, that's log base 2 of 4, that's 2 bits of information. For colors, same thing, 2 bits. Now you might think that the total entropy of X and Y is just the sum of their individual entropies, which would give us 4 bits. But they are not independent. Each fruit restricts the possible colors. An apple could either be red or green. A banana could either be yellow or green. Grape could either be purple or green. A lemon could either be green or yellow. So if you learn the fruit, the color's uncertainty shrinks. For example, if we know that the fruit is an apple, then we only have 2 possibilities for the color, and log base 2 of 2 is 1 bit. So the entropy behind the color in this case, knowing that it's an apple, is 1 bit. It's the same for the banana, 1 bit, same for the grape, 1 bit, same for the lemon, 1 bit. So the average conditional entropy is 1 bit. To calculate the joint entropy, it's actually the entropy of X plus the entropy of Y knowing X. Why is this less than 4 bits? Because knowing the fruit reduces color uncertainty. They're dependent. So if you want to know both the fruit and the color, you would first figure out the fruit, then with that knowledge, figure out the color. Which gives us this formula. If you want to figure X and Y, you would either start off by figuring out X or Y, one of them, then use that knowledge to figure out the other one. Said otherwise, you would figure out X, then Y, knowing X, or vice versa. Oh, by the way, Jake is trying to solve the Rubik's Cube, so if you would like, put a comment cheering him on. He reads them. He will be sad if you don't. Am I manipulating you into leaving a comment? Yes. Please, do it. In all seriousness, that was lovely. Have a great day.